We're going to go ahead and get started. We'd like to thank you all for coming out this morning in the inclement weather. This is a unveiling ceremony of Dr. Mildred F. Jefferson. Today is Thursday, February 22nd, 2018, and we are going to start at 10:03 a.m. All right, I'm your master of ceremony, Angela Bowers, or AJ. We're going to have our invocation by Reverend Scott Reeves, our inspirational singing, our welcome and recognition of officials, our greetings. We're going to have remarks, the history, the professional memories, the family, the journey. Then we're not going to do the bus unveiling, but if you look to your left, you should be able to see her. And then we're going to do the dedication of the bus and a song of victory. So we're going to go ahead and have our invocation by Reverend Scott Reeves.
Would you bow with me? Father God, we thank you today for everyone who's come and gathered in this place today. Lord, we want to acknowledge that we're a needy people in need of a Savior, in need of your mercy and your grace. So we acknowledge now today that you've come to forgive us and call us to be your children. And we thank you for that, Lord. I ask that today, Lord, your presence will be felt in this place. And your spirit would be felt among us as a community here in Carthage, that today we would be one and we would come together and enjoy as we commemorate the life of this great woman. Father, we pray that your blessing would be on this event and that we could all strive to have the kind of life that would have an impact like Dr. Jefferson did. A lasting legacy. And Lord, we pray all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, the name that is above every name, the name that deserves to be glorified through eternity. Amen.
Amen.
We're now going to have our inspirational song by Mr. Bill McKelvey of the Pine Grove Church.
Stand on your promise.
thank Mr. McKelvey for that wonderful selection. We will now have our welcome and recognition of officials by none other than Mr. Otis Amy.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to our celebration of Dr. Mildred Jefferson. We want to thank all of you for taking time out of your busy day to come and share in this momentous occasion. This time I'd like to recognize our officials. So if you would, please, some of you are standing, so just wave so we'll recognize who you are. First, our mayor, Mr. Lynn Vincent. Former city manager, Mr. Charles Thomas. The leader of our Chamber of Commerce, Mrs. Tommy Smith. City commissioners, Mrs. Ida Beck and Mr. Jerry Hansen. State Representative, Chris Patty. Representing State Senator Ryan Hughes, Mr. Roy Wilson. And U.S. Senator, Mr. Louis Gohmert.
We indeed welcome each and every one of you, and thank you all for making time out of your busy schedules to come and share in this momentous occasion. Next, we will have greetings from the Honorable Mayor Lynn Vincent.
Thank you. What a wonderful crowd. Thank you so much for coming out to honor this great lady, Dr. Mildred L. Jefferson. We're honored to have the opportunity to do this. You'll be looking at the plaque after a while. It's a wonderful honor to her. We appreciate the things that she's done for Carthage and for Pinole County, and we welcome each and one of you for coming. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Benson. We will now have our other greeting from none other than Honorable Chris Patty, our state representative.
Thank you, and slight correction, we are honored to have our congressman, Louis Gohmert, here this morning. Always good to have him on the call.
Thank you, Chris.
However, I do believe he could be a senator because he'd be pretty good at filibuster. I've seen him do it.
That I can do.
That he can do, absolutely. Good morning, everyone. It is great to see you this morning. Of course, it's always great for me, as many of you know, to be in my hometown, the place where I grew up as well. And so, certainly as we celebrate someone who called this area home as well. It is great to see, and just another example of some of the wonderful people that come from this community and go on to do wonderful, wonderful things. And so when you look at her accomplishments, I would have loved to have known this wonderful lady. If you read about her, it makes you seem like you're not doing enough if you read it, because if you look at all the accomplishments that she had, the things she did, particularly in the pro-life movement, is just outstanding. The impact she had on so many over her life. Even former President Ronald Reagan, I thought that was an outstanding story as well. And so we're just so thankful for her and her efforts in so many causes and her leadership over time. And we're thankful to call her one of our own. So we're glad to have you here this morning, and I just bid you good morning and thank you for being here. God bless you.
Thank you. Patty. Now we'll have remarks, the history from Mrs. Bonnie Pope, professional memories of Mr. Mark Staminsky, and the family, Pastor Curthell Roberts, the journey from Mr. Mike Parker and Mrs. Sharon Robertson Jones. But first we'll have Mrs. Bonnie Pope, who is a librarian at Carthage High School, give the history.
Thank you. Actually, they have me because I'm the oldest living human being. I was a government teacher there for 27 years. I'm also a child of the 60s. That's hard for us to believe. You know, that we're all walkers now and things. We don't want our grandchildren to know about that generation that we know. But as a government teacher, I'm compelled to want all of my students to know both sides of every issue. As a child of the 60s, I knew the right to choice issue because I was one of those feels good do it generation people. But as a government teacher at Carthage High School, I needed to know the other side, the right to lie child side. So I started reading the most I could find, the most eloquent voice on the right to lie is Miss Jefferson. The more I read her rebuttals, the more I knew that she changed my mind. She changed my heart. She helped change my soul. And just the first thing I read was, she said, I became a physician in order to help save lives. I am at once a physician, a citizen, a woman, and I'm not willing to stand aside and allow the concept of expendable human lives to turn this great land into just another reservation for only the perfect, the privileged, and the plan of a right to live. This was her life. This was her dedication. And she changed mine. And I cannot tell you what I owe to this wonderful, beautiful woman. And I think I would be remiss if I didn't say in her voice, when you look around, she stepped out. And all these public servants, this day and time, to be a public servant, you're really stepping out and putting yourself out there. All of ours, as you see in this room, carried on her tradition. And I'm so thankful and so blessed. Thank you.
And indeed, thank you, Ms. Folk, for coming out and sharing your heartfelt memory. Now we will have her professional memories by Mr. Mark Stavinsky.
First question I always get is, how did you meet Mildred? And the answer is, back in Massachusetts, when I unfortunately lived in Massachusetts, we were both candidates for office, pro-life candidates for office. And needless to say, both of us got slaughtered at the ballot box. I can tell you honestly, as somebody who was a friend of hers for many, many years, if she was here today, she would be embarrassed. Because it was never about her, it was always about the issue, whatever it was she was working on. Now, I was very fortunate to get to know her on a personal basis because, for reasons that are too long to explain, Mildred did not drive. She relied on people like me to take her to her meetings, take her to her speeches, take her to things like even her dentist appointments and to the flower show at the Expo Center, whatever the case may be. So we spent a lot of time together, mostly at red lights in traffic. And it's my belief that she never really got the recognition that she deserved. And I'll give you just two examples because I could go on for days. On the professional level, we would go to various pro-life meetings, and I remember one instance where we went to a particular meeting, and we got there, and there was nobody there. And the reason was, they changed the meeting location because they didn't want Mildred there.
Wow.
They didn't want Mildred there, and I used to tell her, the reason I like working with you is because you are concerned with activity. We got too many people in this country who are concerned more with activity rather than accomplishment. They think that if they're having pro-life meetings and we got a committee at each church, that we're actually fighting the abortion plan, and that's actually not true. With Mildred, she had a plan, she knew what her goals were. And for that reason, I would volunteer the time necessary to help her out on things like that. Second, there was a case in 1995, if I remember the year correctly, because I was just a little boy at the time. A guy by the name of Dr. Kenneth Eveland was trying to perform a late-term abortion, and he had a little problem, and that is that the baby was born alive. So he proceeded to correct that situation by taking the baby's head and putting it in a bucket of water until it died. Now, the local prosecutor heard about that case and said, I got a word for that. It's called manslaughter. So they tried the doctor, found him guilty of manslaughter. And the expert medical witness that they used in that case was Dr. Jefferson. And so she committed one of the absolute mortal sins of medicine, and that is doctors do not testify against other doctors, but she did because it was the right thing to do. One of the events that she asked me to take her to was a celebration of the use of anesthesia in medicine at Boston University Medical School, where she was a professor for some time. And it was very interesting because there was probably a whole bunch of high-powered surgeons, high-powered medical professors, probably some hospital administrators, a lot of muckety-mucks that obviously I didn't know. In fact, the only person I knew in that room was Mildred. And I observed and I watched something very interesting. Nobody would talk to Mildred unless she went up to them and approached them directly. You had an entire room, probably like this here. Nobody would go up and talk to Mildred and at least ask how she's doing and talk to her and thank her for being here. And that's probably a result of the Kenneth Eagle case. And so she suffered both professionally and personally for things like that. One of the things that I learned from Mildred, spending a lot of time with her in automobiles, aside from the time that she was taking a nap when we were going to her various events, Mildred would be silent, and all of a sudden she would exhibit what I would refer to as a fit of frustration. She would just be silent, and all of a sudden she'd go, Mark, I don't understand why God is doing this to us. What does he want from us? Why is he making us work so hard? And then as fast as those events would come up, they just disappear. And if there's any lesson to be learned from that with Mildred, is perseverance. Yes, she was frustrated. You know, I got to see that frustration. Other people got to see her on a professional basis, but I got to know what she was thinking and what she was feeling. And that perseverance was her answer to that. And when you really think about it, that's the type of behavior you would expect from a woman who graduated from high school when most of us were just entering high school. And she graduated from college when most of us were graduating from high school. And she completed her master's degree before most of us completed our bachelor's degree. So for that, perseverance paid off. Now, on a personal note, I want to thank Judge Parker and you good people of Texas for erecting the bust on Town Hall, because at least now we have a way of keeping Mildred's memory alive. I've said it before, I'll say it again, she never quite got the recognition and appreciation she deserved, but now hopefully we have a way of keeping her memory alive.
We do appreciate you for traveling so far and so long to come to show your support and give your fondest memories of her as well. We will now have Pastor Kurthel Roberts give us just a little bit of an insight of what it was growing up with Dr. Jefferson.
Thank you very much, and to all of you, happy to see you and very thankful that for you to come for this occasion. I didn't grow up with her. She was much older than I. But I did grow up with her. Now, a little bit about her that I don't know whether any of you know where Walnut Grove community is, but I'm going to take one trip north of town, 5 miles, and take a look, and you'll see there are no street lights or trolleys or any of those things. Mildred, our cousin, and before I go further, all of the direct cousins, will you stand? Mildred was the third oldest grandchild of my grandfather, George Roberts, who was a Baptist preacher. Her mother and my dad were brothers and sisters. She was born in Pittsburg only because her father had an assignment there when he was a CME preacher, a Methodist preacher. And her mom was a school teacher. The grit, the tenacity, the desire, the diligence that you see in her life came from my grandmother, who was a teacher, her mother, who was a teacher, and her granddad, who was a preacher. In the days of, in the early days, and as my cousin, who has gone on now, many of you knew her, Fanny Roberts Thompson, they grew up together. It was about a year and a half, 2 years difference in their ages. And Mildred was so engrossed in learning that she studied all the time. And I'm getting this from her as I would visit her, as well as from my cousin. Fanny grew up with a clipped tongue. At 5 years old, Mildred was 7. And because of her studies and she wanted to be in medicine, she took a pair of scissors and clipped the cleftness of Fanny's tongue. Fanny's 5, she's 7. And if you knew Fanny, she had no drawback in speaking after that. But upon my last going to Cambridge to see her, one of the things that really stood out, she wanted to really come back to East Texas. She made had a great career. Things hadn't worked in the Right to Life movement, as you the speaker said, as she would like, but because, and she didn't realize what she did because she was always looking at a goal further. And little did she know, she had made some indelible prints upon the whole annals of time in the work that she did. Our family held her in high esteem, and she was a mark on the wall because all of us, as we went through school, as my grandson texted this morning when I told him I was where I was going, he said, "Granddaddy, that means that nobody of us should have an excuse." That if she could come from such a meager background and to ascend by the grace of God to the point that she did, then there are no excuses. Thank you very much, and I appreciate Mr. Parker for having called me one February morning and asked me about Mildred, and we got the journey, and he got the journey going. God bless you.
I enjoyed the story about the about flipping the tongue. I don't let anybody get in my mouth. It just shows that she was dedicated even at a young age. Now we have the journey by Mr. Mike Parker, of law offices of Mike Parker, and Mrs. Sharon Robertson Jones, who is the head director of Excellent Teen Choice.
Well, good morning. Thank you, everybody, for coming out this morning. And as much as I'd like to, I'm not going to make a speech this morning. First thing I want to say is that my part on this program is entitled The Journey. And I want to tell you right now, the journey is not over. We are at a very significant milestone along the way. We have erected the bust, and the weather might cooperate here. We might get to go over there and look at what Bob Harness has created there. But the journey is not over. We still want to endow a scholarship at Panola College. We still want to have a portion of the collection of her papers that are now at Harvard brought to Panola College. And we want to do that. So we won't just have this today and then forget again about this wonderful person that this county was blessed with. We want her name to be mentioned to every graduating class from now on in Carthage High School and throughout the county, because her life serves as a challenge and an inspiration to every person that faces any kind of difficulty or adversity, no matter what that is. Her life is just remarkable. And so this journey has begun, but it is not over by any means. And so if any of you have the means or the resources or the contacts to help that become a reality, please help us all that you can. I just want to say this one thing. When I was in high school, we had to memorize the Gettysburg Address, and it's been a while, and I don't remember it, and I'm not going to try to do it. But as I was standing over there, this occurred to me, and I wish that I could remember this exactly. But one of the things that Abraham Lincoln said in that brilliant, inspired moment at Gettysburg was that nothing he could say on that occasion could hallow and consecrate and dedicate that ground, because the contributions of those people who had given their life there and shed their blood there had hallowed that ground and consecrated it far beyond anything that he could add to it by anything he would say on that moment. And that's kind of how I feel this morning. It's appropriate that we stop and take this opportunity to remember and honor Dr. Jefferson. But the real honor and glory of her life are those thousands or tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of lives that have been lived that without her standing in the way might have been carelessly and thoughtlessly terminated. How many people have a life because of what she did and what she said and how passionately she articulated that pro-life vision that she had? And so it's appropriate that we're doing what we are doing, but those lives are the real testament to her life. But having said that, what I want to do with the remainder of my time, I just want to thank a lot of people. This has been one of the most enjoyable things I have ever had the opportunity to do because of the people that I've had the opportunity to work with. And I shouldn't do this because I know I'm going to leave some people out. But when I first read Dr. Jefferson's obituary, the very first person that I talked to after my wife, Karen, of course, was my dear friend, Claire Jones, who was our county clerk. And I told her, I said, I just feel like we need to do something. Can you point me in the right direction on how we could achieve that as a community? And so she gave me some names of some people that I needed to talk to. And so we formed a little committee and began talking about how we could achieve this. And so first, I want to mention the members of the committee. Reverend Kerthel Roberts, who you've already met this morning. And I just want to say this. If I didn't get anything else out of this, having become friends with Kerthel Roberts would have made it all worthwhile. I've enjoyed every minute I've spent with him on this, and you can see why. Ethelyn Brewster, Lacey Jones, Glendale Chadwick, Wanda Gaines, and those were the original members of the committee. And then I went over and talked to Bob Harness. And Bob told me that actually his neighbor across the street, Brenda Giles, had already compiled a lot of information and documentation about Dr. Jefferson's life, because she had used her life as a lesson in her gifted and talented class, I think. Is that right, Brenda? And so all the information that I needed had already been assembled by Brenda. And then Bob Harness, whose artistry has just transformed our community and made it just a unique place in East Texas already, agreed to be very generous about helping us create this sculpture. Jim Holder at Complete Printing, Jerry and Wanda Hansen at KGAS, as they always do, were behind anything that's positive in our community. The Panola Watchman, the Commissioner's Court. And I don't really want to say anything negative here, and I'm not going to, but there was some apprehension and concern on the part of some people that the Commissioner's Court might not allow us to erect a statue to Dr. Mildred Faye Jefferson on the town square. But I am happy to tell you that when we approached them with the idea, their response was immediate and enthusiastic and unanimous, which made me feel even better about our wonderful community. The Commissioner's Court, Leanne Jones, John Gradbird, Dale Legrone, Rodney Legrone, Craig Lawless, now in Precinct 3. I want to thank all of our contributors. Pete Tomiato, who observed me the other day, I do know how to operate a pair of post hole diggers. I will say I did let Pete get the heavy end of that, carrying it over there. Ladies that I'm privileged to work with at my law office, Lindsay Williamson and LaDonna Davis, have certainly contributed a lot to this project. Most of the officials and dignitaries have already been introduced. Senator Ted Cruz and Senator John Cornyn have both sent us things from the Capitol, and Louis Gohmert sent us a very nice proclamation. They're going to be on display over here where you can see those after this. I'm not going to take time to read all of those to you, but I just want to thank everybody that has contributed in any way, financially or with your time or your support, or just being here this morning. Thank you very, very much. And remember, we're just taking a rest. We're not through with the journey. And then last, but absolutely not least, I want to tell you, I owe a special debt of gratitude to Kelly Reeves, because she put me in touch with the most energetic person I think I've ever met, Sharon Robertson Jones. Don't put her on a committee unless you are prepared to step aside. The train roll on. She took this project that I had allowed to languish far too long and got us where we are today. And Sharon, I just thank you so, so much. And I'm really happy. Thank you all for being here, and I believe, Sharon, you're going to share your thoughts with us now. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I grew up in a Pentecostal church, so I know how to talk. But really, I'm a situational extrovert, which means that I only speak when I really have to. I would like to thank Mike and all of his leadership, and Reverend Kurt Dale, and to the Carthage ISD, Carthage Independent School District, who allowed excellent teen choice to come into the district to do this project. At the time, Mr. Otis Amy, he was the principal there, and Ms. Bunny Pope, she was actually one of my teachers, as well as Ms. Brenda Watson-Giles. But what I love about their spirit is that they were also cooperative, and Ms. Bunny Pope, I think, was the most emotional about it. And when we had the program at the high school, she just simply said, it's about time. And you can tell with her emotions that she was very deeply touched. And I can appreciate that. And for the Roberts family, thank you for allowing us to share Dr. Mildred Jefferson with hundreds of children at the high school and junior high level. To A.J. Bowers, A.J. last year, he was a senior at the high school, and he's the one who headed up the program at the high school, and then he said, let's take it across the track. Let's take it to Bethlehem. And he was responsible for taking a program to Bethlehem, in which Scott and Kelly Reed sang in the choir and just joined right in. But it's important that we remember where we started from. And we try to influence, and it's not just the black kids that are at risk. All kids are at risk. All of them need some type of encouragement, every one of them. And so we're trying to show them love. If you ever get a chance to talk to a student, we're excellent teen choice by choice. Talk to them, give them an encouraging word, tell them that they can make it. That one little word may help them go on to be doctors, lawyers, senators, state representatives, and we all need someone, right? Okay, so welcome to Excellent Teen Choice, and I am so sorry, we really had no idea so many people were coming, we would have made 1,000 programs. But I think right now what we're going to do, we're going to have Mr. Brown to sing the last song, and I do believe we're going to go across, and we're going to do the unveiling over there, but we do have snacks, we have coffee, we have punch. Trust me, I didn't do any of that, okay? And then I think we'll go from there, okay? This is Mr. Brown, James Brown. Not to get on down, James Brown.
Good. All right, James.
Excellent. Oh, you're excellent. You're excellent. Ooh. Oh, you're so excellent. Oh, that is your name.
As we wait on all the others to gather, who would have thought after 2 days of nothing but deluge, we would get a wonderful day for the unveiling. This is certainly a monumental occasion, not just because of the fact of Mildred, but the fact that the community has come together to say, hey, this is worth us gathering. Is Mike?
Yeah.
You want to come and stand? Sharon, did you have?
Congressman Louis Gohmert has prioritized being here today when he could have been a lot of other places.
Yeah.
And I would just like for him to have an opportunity to address you.
Well, I'm just grateful to be here. Until Mark brought these things to my attention about this incredible woman, I thought maybe the most impactful person I'd ever met was Charles Thomas. But what an incredible woman. What she did with her life, and my mother was brilliant and hard-headed. She put herself through Baylor from an alcoholic dad and poor family, but what an extraordinary life. And I couldn't help but think there would be people wondering when they heard that she at one time said, you know, why is God making it so hard? Yet we know the one perfect person in the whole history of the world cried out in frustration the same way, why have you forsaken me? And he was perfect. So it's what we do about it. And this extraordinary woman, I'm just so grateful to know about her. And we have gotten about her and what she did, gotten that in the congressional record. But anybody here that has any of her writings, anything that I could share on the floor of the House, I would love to do that. This hero for people should be more widely known. And I just finished by saying, you know, it would have been easy as a little child just to follow what everybody else was doing.
Praise you.